Hello, my cherished friends in Monet Cafe. I'm so excited to be bringing you this painting. Oh, I'm in my studio. Yay! It feels so good. I'm excited. I'm going to show you some of the things I'm using to create this impressionistic painting. I'm going to begin with some new pastels, spelled N-U-P-A-S-T-E-L-S. It's not new like N-E-W, but they're very hard and very good for getting your sketch in to begin with. This is on UART paper. And it's a paper I know I talk about a lot. It's one of my favorites, but I have a lot of papers and surfaces that I use, as well as creating my own, which I love to do. And I have some videos about that as well. So I'm going to try to keep this video as much of a real-time video as possible, because I know you guys love that. And I understand that, because when I was first beginning pastels, some of the speed videos were just kind of hard to follow. I was like, you know, everything was brand new to me, so I needed to watch everything. So hopefully this will help some of you who request for the real-time videos. So once again, this was just a darker new pastel that I used to get in the tree line. I didn't do much of a value study with the one dark pastel in this case, because I wanted to just go ahead and start laying in some color, some kind of big blocks of color to get my general composition in. And again, I stress this in all my videos, is work large to small, less detail to more detail. We call it often as artists blocking in. So we have a tendency always to go in and get all those little details. I mean, even with those trees, I didn't focus on anything other than the shape of the tree or the tree line. And now I'm just kind of focusing in on some of the colors. And, you know, on our Facebook group, Monet Cafe Art Group, I get a lot of great questions. And one of the questions is, how do you decide? Are you going to do an underpainting to begin with? Are you going to do something with local color? Are you going to do something with complementary color? If you're just beginning, these terms all might sound like, there's so much to learn. But trust me, you can learn it all. If I can learn it, you can learn it. But sometimes it's just a matter of your mood. And in this particular case, this was such a precious moment for me. I'm doing a voiceover now after the painting, because some of you know, and you might be getting tired of me talking about the flooding of my art studio in my home, but it's been a long time since I've gotten some just dedicated time to paint, just some spontaneous time to paint. Our lives have been so busy just getting everything restored. So this was one of those moments where I turned up the music. I can't play that music. This is some YouTube music that I get. People often ask about the music I use. You have to use music that has no copyright. But the music that I play, if you want some good music to paint to, look for an artist named Lindsay Sterling. She plays some violin music that's very energetic. And I was just, by the end of this, I was almost dancing when I was painting. And sometimes the mood helps you to stay impressionistic too. So if you put on some good music and, you know, just get the vibes going, that really helps. So again, I'm just laying down some general values. Instead of doing it like I've done sometimes with just one color, you can do a value study with one pastel color. I'm doing it in big blocks of color. And this is what's called using local color, meaning the color that's in the scene, in the photograph, or in the actual place that you are, you know, if you're painting plein air on location. So as in contrast to complementary color, you might check out some of my other videos where I talk about using complementary color. I also love that technique. So again, sometimes the technique just depends on your mood. And if you're just starting out, a lot of times it's you don't have a lot of techniques under your belt. You've just got to start practicing some of them. So practice, practice, practice. That is the way to get better. And again, in our group, Monet Cafe Art Group on Facebook, you do have to ask to join. And but if you answer the questions and say that you saw or you found out about the group from me on the YouTube channel, you're almost you know, guaranteed to be accepted into the group. It's an amazing group, though, because beginners, you are so welcome. You have nothing to worry about sharing your art. You can't ask a question that's a dumb question, because we all started somewhere. So anyway, that's just a beautiful way to feel welcome and learn things. Now, my paper here, I pointed at that, it had a wave in it. I have another video where I show how to flatten out UART paper if you get it bowed or buckled. And this was one of those pieces that I had to correct. And so I'm kind of having to work around one of the bumps in it that didn't go away. That's why that pastel isn't laying down very flat. But it's okay because I'm going to blend it all in anyway and work around it. Besides, this is Impressionism, and sometimes the little inconsistencies can help things look even more real. A neat thing about nature is that it has what I like to call a spontaneous harmony. There is harmony, there is design, there is beauty that comes from order and design. But the spontaneity of it all, I like to think of how God, you know, just causes a big wind to flow across a field of flowers, and there's a motion, almost like a musical movement of it, but there's still a harmony there. So sometimes in our art, if we get things just too fixed, we lose that music to your painting. And so that's what I hope to achieve in making this video, is to help you understand just how to keep things loose and not too fixed. Now, I already feel like my background trees are getting a little too fixed there, so in the future of this video anyway, I give it some more jagged edges on the top and let them reach up into the sky a little bit more. But in pastels, it's a little opposite of some mediums. You typically put down your darker colors first and your lighter colors last. Now, you don't always have to do that, but it's a good rule of thumb when you're beginning. So especially when you're doing, like in this particular reference photo, I'm squinting all the time to see my values. You know, I talk about value is king, and value simply means how dark or light something is. And as a standard rule of thumb, values are darker in the foreground and lighter in the background. Now, I know those background trees look pretty dark right now, but again, you can put down your darks first. I'm gonna lighten them up, as you'll see as we go on, with some cooler and lighter values to push them back into the distance. And the reason, that's a scientific thing, actually. The reason things do lighten in value in the distance is because of atmosphere. For example, everybody thinks air is nothing. Well, atmosphere and air actually has substance. And the more atmosphere or air or distance of that air between you and the background, the lighter it gets, and also the more washed out and paler the colors become. Perfect example is mountains. If you're ever, you know, somewhere in a mountainous scene where you can see very far away, the mountains typically don't appear green like the trees that are on the mountains. They appear bluish purple. That's because things blue out and pale out in the distance. So that is one of the best rules of thumbs. First two things I can mention here is, one, blocking in big shapes, not much detail. You're really just getting in values. And second, of course, values, getting your values correct. So as you can see, I'm just getting in a really loose general composition here, and it really helps to just set that mood of getting an impressionistic painting. Big strokes. Another thing, probably a third thing, is the direction of your strokes. Again, this field of poppies, I called it poppy dance because they seem to just be dancing from the foreground to the background, that beautiful harmony, and you want to emulate that in the direction of your strokes. So that has a huge impact on the feel of the painting. So if the grasses and the poppies are leaning harmoniously in one way or the other, you want to try to capture that by how you move your pastel. Now, another thing that I'm doing here is things don't only get paler in value in the distance, they get closer together and less detail. So again, see those grasses in the back there? They are not as broad and bold and big strokes as they are in the foreground, because things get smaller and less detail in the background. So already we've hit like three or four things in just good art that will help you to create a painting that represents reality in your own impressionistic way. So I'm gonna just paint here a little bit, and I'll add some commentary as I see that it's needed. All right, here we go. Yes, sometimes I just feel something in the music and I enjoy this process so much and having fun and dancing while I'm painting. Now this is a regular spritzer, like a body mist spritzer that I use to put in some alcohol and water. I think it's about half and half. And I'm using a wide flat brush where I'm going to really blend the background. It's like a method to do like a wet underpainting. And the only reason for alcohol is it dries faster. You could use water, you know, if you don't have any alcohol. But I have a clean paper towel, and I'll explain this technique as I go. I'm just shaking up the spritzer, and I'm spraying it. I usually work top to bottom, but I definitely work in sections. For example, this blue sky here, I'm working kind of down to blend it. And I don't want to get that dark tree line in my brush because it would like contaminate that sky. So I'm being a little careful here. And just so you know, drips are okay in this. Sometimes I spray, I'm a little heavy-handed with the alcohol, and it drips and runs down the UART paper. And it actually kind of lends towards the impressionism. It really helps. So now I'm, again, I cleaned off my brush really good. And I'm spraying some of the darker areas now, and I'm going to specifically work on just the darker sections. Again, those trees in the background, they're going to get lightened up a little bit, but they're dark because they're vertical. That's something I learned as an artist, that the things that are vertical in a scene are typically darker because the sun is not shining on the vertical part, it's shining on the top part. So trees are typically lighter on the top, but not on the sides. And again, cleaning out my brush. Now I'm going to work on these background areas. Again, I'm focusing on the motion of the grasses. Those background grasses are pretty tight and close together, so I just little short strokes there. But as I go on, I make the broader strokes and start letting that the little drips happen and everything. So it's kind of fun. I love this part of the painting. And sometimes I think I would really just love doing just the underpainting part and very little pastel, so that might be something I do in the future. I thought I would mention here that often you can use some of the, like the darker area in the front there. As I'm using my brush, I still have some of the darker on the brush, so I'm using it almost like just to paint. You see, I added some of the darker areas. If you look at the photograph, you can see where flowers grow down to the ground, you really see it in the foreground. It gets darker down by the roots, and that progressively gets lighter as you go in the background, but that's why I added some of that kind of in the mid-ground of the painting there, where you've still got some of those roots showing. And again, it's just going to get less and less as you go to the background. You're not seeing the roots anymore because of the distance and the angle of your vision. So it's often really interesting how you can do the underpainting and establish a lot of the correctness of the painting before you even start to lay down the pastels. Now here, of course, I'm just blow drying the painting so that I can work faster. Alcohol does dry pretty quickly, but I keep my blow dryer just plugged in. This is just like a spare blow dryer I use just for my art. And it just makes it really handy when you're, like, again, when you're in the mood and you don't want to wait. And it's just fun. You see how it did dry lighter. You know, of course, everything's going to dry lighter in many types, different types of medium. So that's pretty normal. All right, so now time to apply more pastel on top of the underpainting that's been blended with the alcohol wash. So this, all of it's fun, but I really love this stage where I get to kind of go in and start really making some more suggestive marks and really start establishing what the painting is going to be instead of just the underpainting. Again, working big to small, less detail to more detail. The background, you never want too much detail anyway. You see me blending a little with my finger. I don't do that a lot, but sometimes if something's just not just right, I'll use my finger. But then I'll also use, you'll see in a little while, where I use a piece of pipe foam insulation. There it is. Oh no, that's a pastel. But I'll talk about the pipe foam insulation more in a minute. Now that's actually what I'm using there. It's more of a deep bluish purple. And it's really a great idea to lay down multiple colors. It's going to make everything more interesting. You see how those trees are already more interesting with that deep purple in there? It's also a great idea to have a little congruency in your painting and to keep the colors kind of consistent throughout. So putting that purple in the deep grasses there is just going to make the painting more harmonious and pull together better. I wish I could think of all the right words to say here, but it just kind of creates the same. And I think that's because of what happens in color and nature, is that often the lighting and everything that's in the surroundings, colors play upon each other. So it's really just kind of emulating nature with that. Now, again, I'm doing the same thing in these foreground grasses. I'm just establishing more of the darks, but I'm also using various dark colors. If I was just to use that dark, actually I think that really dark color is more of like a dark burgundy, really dark purplish color, and then that medium to dark bluish purple there. So it creates a lot more interest. Now I've got a darker green, but it's not quite as dark in value as the purples and the dark burgundy I added there. That's going to be more of a mid to dark value color. And if you look again at the reference photo, you can see where some of those, as I'm drawing, squint your eyes and look at the reference photo, and you can see where those middle area of the photograph, where the roots of the flowers are going down, that's what I'm establishing here. And I'm going to progressively get a lighter touch and lighter values in the distance. Notice how I changed, not here, but in the other, just a second ago, the colors in the background, oh, actually that is lighter too. I decreased the value as I moved back, and I'm still establishing it throughout the painting to give some congruency and harmony there. And I'm really just trying to emulate those grasses and roots of the flowers going down and gradually getting lighter and less detail as I move back into the background. Art is all about illusion. I think I love art so much for multiple reasons, but one of the reasons is I got very into illusion when I was a kid. I don't like to call it magic because I think of magic as like dark magic, but I love illusion. I love even optical illusions, tricks of the eyes and things like that. And that's exactly what art is. It's an optical illusion. We're taking a three-dimensional world and trying to represent it on a two-dimensional surface so that it appears three-dimensional. And it's really just a lot of rules you have to learn. Now, a lot of people have a gift to be able to do this more naturally than others. There are going to be those wonderfully talented people. I believe I have a gift of color and a gift of value, but there's other gifts I don't have that some of you might have, you know. So the cool thing is that if you love it and you're fascinated by it, you can learn the rules, you know. And that's really one of the great things, is that if you just study it enough and not only become a student of art, become a student of nature. That's the beautiful thing about God's world, is that art allows you to see the world through an artist's eyes. You're going to start looking at everything in a different way. Your friends and family may think you're strange because all of a sudden you're squinting when you're out with everybody and you're just looking at nature all the time, and you really learn to start looking at the world. And it's a beautiful thing because you start seeing the beauty when many people are just looking at their cell phones. So that's a great thing about being an artist. So I just always want to encourage you guys to love our earth that's so beautiful, and to just continue to experience it as an artist. So anyway, a little more painting here. Just keep enjoying this process. I know I sure was as I was painting. I thought I would pop in here and add some commentary as I'm beginning to start the flowers in this part. I'm choosing my reds, and I'm starting to work on those background flowers, which of course, like we talked about before, things in the distance don't have as much detail, and they're smaller, obviously. Sometimes you can also just really lay down, almost like the side of your pastel, and lay down like a light touch of like a coating of flowers across the back, instead of getting so specific. Some of my marks here are more like individual flowers, and some are more like kind of groupings of flowers. So, you know, you really have some options there, but in the distance, they're not going to be spaced as far apart as they would be in the foreground. So that's why sometimes in the far distance, you can do, you know, just almost like a layer of flowers across the grass. Again, I'm just creating that sense of illusion and depth. I'm also trying to mimic the motion of the flowers. If you notice, in the reference photo, it almost looks like there's a slight hill to the field, like it's bowed down. So that's what I'm trying to emulate with those background flowers. Now, a lot of times I will, obviously the flowers in the foreground, they're getting a little bit more brilliant in color. I'm making my marks a little bit stronger. And this is a Terry Ludwig pastel that you see I'm using here. They are really just such a great pastel for putting on towards the end of your painting. And they work really well when your painting or your surface has already had a lot of pastel layered onto it. Now, I still at this point have a decent amount of tooth left to the pastel, so I'm still able to get in some good layers. What really helps with that too is the alcohol wash that I did in the beginning. It tends to keep the pastels from getting so deep into the grain or the grit that it allows you to really have more of a surface to work on after the alcohol wash. So that's really a benefit. Now, a lot of times, like I said, I lay down the darkest darks, which is kind of like the base of the flower, and then I'll put the petals on, the lighter petals on top of the darker color. Now, those distance flowers, they're actually, even though typically you don't use warmer colors in the distance, that part of the field back there, it's not as bright in the photo as I made it in my painting, but I almost felt like the sun was like really just shining back there. And so I chose more of a coral type of a red in the distance back there. And again, you barely see those up in the top of the field there in the top right. You can barely even distinguish them as flowers. So again, things just getting more subtle and less detailed in the distance really helps to create that illusion. So enjoy while I create more of these flowers, and I've really been enjoying this painting. to mention here that when you're painting flowers, often we have this tendency to paint all of the petals and sort of paint them all the same way. And that is not how it works in nature. Flowers have their own personality, and often they're moving in different ways. Some are bending over, some are facing different directions. So think in terms of shapes. When you're looking at your reference photo, try to forget that they're flowers and just focus on the shape that they are. And there's a fine line with painting quickly and painting messy. So painting quickly and having it look impressionistic is something that comes with just lots of practice. You know, so your marks become more purposeful. And this is also a point in the painting I like to mention. I have the advantage when I videotape my process of being able to look back at different places where I'm like, it would have been nice to maybe stop sooner than I did. That happens. I'm sure many of you can relate. And in this painting, I was very happy with the final, but I do, all right, at this point, I like the looseness here, maybe with just a few more grasses, but I do decide to continue working. And again, it's all a learning process, even for me. Well, this was certainly a wonderful painting experience for me, just to have some carefree and relaxing time to paint and really enjoy the process. This one was fun. So I hope you learned more about impressionistic painting and how to keep things loose. And also, I hope you'll subscribe to the channel if you like it. You'll just have to hit the subscribe button or just click the icon with my face on it at the end of this video. And again, please join us in Monet Cafe Art Group on Facebook. It's a growing community of artists of every level, learning and growing together. And as always, happy painting. Feel free to check out some of my other tutorial videos, because art truly does make life better.